Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellency, distinguished guests, thank you so much for being here for this session. We're going to look at energy and sustainability. And we have a very energetic panel here that we have in place. Thank you, Khulood, for introducing us all. We have a lot to talk about, and we're going to look at the future of energy and sustainability in this region. Now, when you think about energy and sustainability together, you know, they haven't always ran in parallel lines. In fact, when you look back at history, what has fueled progression? What has fueled industry? In fact, it has been energy, and often to the detriment of depleting and using the natural resources that we have. But this doesn't work anymore. And this is a situation that we saw as not sustainable, not just here in the UAE, in the few short years that people have been working diligently to put this country and to put this emirate on the map. It's the situation in the whole world. So not alone is it not sustainable, it doesn't make good economic sense. And people have woken up to this, and people are doing something about it. Now, many of you might have seen the Dubai Sustainability Report. It's an incredible document. I haven't read it all, but it's well worth a look. It has some wonderful information in there. And the motto in there that DEWA has, the motto is for generations to come. And this gives great credence to that wonderful old saying that we did not inherit this land from our forefathers. We simply borrowed it from our grandchildren. And just to make sure that it's there a long time longer, there's a question I want to put to my panel now. We all talk about sustainability. I think every industry in the world now is looking at sustainability. Everybody wants to be sustainable. But what is sustainability? What does it look like? What does it feel like? Mr. Altair, I've seen your great report, and I know the work that's been going on here in recent years. For you at DEWA, what is sustainability all about?
First of all, sustainability, I will take you to our vision, where our vision is to become a sustainable world-class utility. And going back to the report, actually, we have more than 10 initiatives and about maybe 10 programs also. Most of the programs are mega projects, and one of the projects I would like to speak about is the line loss. The line loss started in 1996. Actually, our line loss at that time around 7.2%. Presently, actually, our line loss, it's about 3.5. It's the lowest worldwide. How we done it? I think we done it through action plan and more initiative and initiative in respect of the quality of the specification. We change our specification from British standard to European specification. Second thing is we phase out the 33 kV substation, and the system is used to be 132 kV to 33 to 6.6. Now, at that time, we raised the carrying capacity of the cable from 6.6 to 11 kV. This gave us more current carrying capacity, and also we phase out the 33. And also, we change our evaluation and tender. We used to purchase a transformer and cable based on quoted price. We revise it to evaluated price. I don't want to go in detail, but this is one issue. Second thing about the 400 megawatt, what we have done, actually, we increased the efficiency in the power plant by introducing state-of-the-art technology, either fogging or evaporative cooling or thermal storage. Now, this is about sustainability. We save in fuel. Actually, if you want now to build a similar plant, it will cost you more than 2.5 billion dirham. But actually, with our total investment in this project, not more than 220 million. The third thing, as you know, that we are a utility, we are producing power and potable water. Now, the fuel utilization at the plant, I remember, in 1990, it was around in Jabal Ali, it's around 28%. Today, we have three plants, the efficiency is 90%. Wow. Fuel utilization, it means that only we have 10% emission. Of course, actually, we are very committed towards sustainability, and we have a clear commitment regarding emission reduction. Yes. Very clear roadmap and action plan taken place when required.
Well, super. I mean, that's sustainability and efficiency in action, without a doubt, I think. So well done on that. I mean, and there are some incredible figures in terms of moving that. And at this project management conference, when you think of it, huge projects that were actually put in place to achieve this efficiency. Your Excellency, if I may pass to you now, if I can, Mr. Al-Salah, tell me, when you look at it on a broader scale, when you're looking at the federal region, I mean, what do you then look in terms of sustainability there?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Sustainability means less consumption in our terminology. Meet the demand without compromising the ability of the next generation. Sustainability means reserve the resources. I do think that in our behavior, in our habits, we are not doing any favor to the sustainability actually. We are not reserving any resources. There are a lot of violations in terms of consumption of power and water, and certain measures has to be taken just to reserve or to keep that resources alive.
And indeed, we'll go more into that in a few minutes, but that's certainly, and not just a case, I think, in this region, but indeed around the world, I think we might hear that from many other people. Dr. Belhoul, when we look at what you're doing in Masdar 2, how do you sit back and look at sustainability? What does it feel to you? What does it look like?
I think sustainability can be defined in many different shapes and forms. I personally define it in a very simple way. Sustainability to me is a capacity to endure. But let me first ask you a question. Does anybody here know how many people are expected to be on Earth by 2050? Today we stand at 6 to 7 billion, and that figure will be about 9 to 11 billion. Now that's 4 to 5 billion more people on the same planet requiring the same resources, access to water, access to energy, and access to food. Now as we speak today, there's poverty, there's conflict. Now imagine that being multiplied. So I think by us not including sustainability in a really meaningful matter, this will become a more prevailing issue. Now, to add another level of complexity, you need to also consider the interdependency between energy and water. You need energy to create water. So for example, in the UAE, we use desalination plants, which requires a lot of energy. But at the same time, you need water to produce energy. In fact, 50% of global water being supplied is used again for energy. So I think the limited resources, the interlink between electricity and water provides a very big challenge. Now you asked me about Masdar. With Masdar, we try to embrace that challenge. We have announced earlier this year a pilot project, actually four projects, where we test renewable energy sources for desalination. These plants are being constructed. They will be operational by Q1. And within 18 months, whichever is prevailing technology will be deployed across Abu Dhabi. That's our effort to try and de-link the interdependency between energy and water, but that's only a small step. I think if we truly want to achieve sustainability, we require more partnership between government and private sector.
And again, sometimes I think we're hearing more and more of those projects. Mr. Altai perhaps will enlighten us on some of them later, and you know, some good news coming in that section. Dr. Gelman, you come from a European background, but you've traveled around the world and you've worked in America, you've worked in Europe. Where do you look at sustainability? And when you're advising your clients, what are they looking for?
May I share first the vision Germany as a country and also our company have? And we would like to transform the energy system to a sustainable one and to a smart one. And that is related, on the one hand, to reduce CO2, which renewable of really reduction of CO2. And if you can grab a little bit by numbers, then in Germany we have overall 180 gigawatts installed capacity. And out of that are already 100 renewable energy. And that sees how far we are already in that kind of transition and process. And another number which is probably interesting is that in peak time, when the wind is really blowing and the solar PVs are producing, we have already 70% in our distribution grid renewable energy. So that is a challenge we are facing as of today and not tomorrow, which is influencing our structure, how we deal with technology completely differently to the past.
Now, Mr. Altair, when we look at the situation here in the UAE, we're a big player on the global energy map, a big producer and a big member of OPEC. This is an oil-producing country for the world and indeed for the domestic audience. But of course, we're also looking at the diversification here. But what do you find are the sustainable challenges, really, when you're relying on the traditional form of energies? And really, how do you think we're going to be able to address those challenges?
Of course, the environment and the impact of the environment is a challenge because, as you know, 60% of the consumption of energy is in cooling. And not only in UAE, but also in AGCC and the country, we have the same temperature, I think, high humidity. Therefore, the consumption of electricity is very high, and it is a challenge. And how to mitigate this, I think, what we done in Dubai through Dubai Supreme Council, we introduced the Integrated Energy Strategy 2030. It is a fuel mix, consists of renewable 5%, clean coal, 12%, nuclear 12%, and gas is 71% by 2030. And presently, the gas is about 99%, diesel 1%. Second thing, I think it is very important to change the mindset, to change the behavior of people. This is require a lot of cooperation between all agencies, between the education sector, between the media, and also government departments, in order to reduce the consumption by 2030 by 30%, and in order to manage the demand. Of course, there is a very clear strategy that we have. One of the initiatives is the green building. I think the green building will improve the efficiency by 30%. And also, beside that, the retrofit. Retrofit, it means that we have more than 30,000 buildings. We need to retrofit and upgrade the component of this building in order to be more sustainable building. There are many initiatives from Diwa toward
your own building, leading the way. Your own building, yes.
Definitely, we have the biggest building in the world from government point of view, the largest, and the efficiency of this building is 60% in power and 48% in water, and also the connected load is about 1.2 megawatt, 50% of it solar panel.
So, and you can help other buildings look like that.
Definitely. Right? This will set an example for the future.
Super. Now, you talked, and I want to come back to Dr. Galman on this one, please, too. The mix of, you know, fuel, clean coal, gas, and that. Talk to us a little bit in terms of what RWE is doing with some of the projects that you've got in place here, looking at new power plants, looking at perhaps what you might have in mind for Hassian.
Yeah, that is a very interesting, very important point, because I think it was quite visionary to diversify here the portfolio in terms of energy resources. And we have seen that a lot, and we also refurbished our plants. And give you an example, yeah? We are building a new coal station with 1,600 megawatts, which has a net efficiency of 46%. And we save with that 20% absolute coal, from the old system to the new system. And that is, for me, a very clear signal and a contribution for CO2 reduction, which makes it really concrete and really tangible. And that is why we are also, and we do that together with DEWA, we founded a joint venture called RWE Middle East with the purpose to support exactly these regional companies here overall to design, implement sustainable strategies and implement them. And I would like to emphasize implementation because since that is such a buzzword, that sustainability, that I like to get as concrete as possible with these examples.
Now, some people might be a little hesitant when the concept of clean coal, and it depends who you're talking to on the debate. But obviously, with DEWA and yourself, you're convinced there is clean coal out there, yeah? It's the way forward.
Yeah, definitely.
One of the ways.
There is two type of green coal, ultra super critical, and this is, I think, most expensive. But in general, I mean, you know, when we started this strategy, first of all, we study United States of America fuel mix. In the state, they have 50% of their generation is coal, but it's not clean.
Yes, it's not.
Okay. Now, they have, the remaining is 20% solar, wind, and also they have the gas. Now they have shale gas, and they try to reduce the percentage of coal. Also, if you go to South Korea, it's the same thing. 30% is clean coal, or 30% nuclear, and remaining different type of renewable.
But again, it's all about that.
So we are actually, we're saying we are putting only 12%, and it's a clean coal. What does it mean, clean coal? It means that you have to use the best available technology. This is number one. Number two, actually, we are using the best standard in the world, the European standard. It's very strict, where the emission will be limited to acceptable standard.
And again, it's about that diversification of energy. Dr. Belhul, talk to us about what you're doing in Masdar. I mean, when we look and think of Masdar, you really took the first step in this region, particularly looking at solar. Bring us up to date with what you've been doing.
Sure. Allow me first to answer the second part of your question around solar. Today, as we speak, there is a plan today in Abu Dhabi, in the Western region, supplying 100 megawatts of power, solar power, which is sufficient to fuel 20,000 houses. Now, this is only one project. Dubai has announced the Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Solar Park, which is a great initiative. And we are tendering, DEWA is tendering a project right now. So I think if you look at the local area, and even within the wider MENA area between Morocco, Egypt, and Jordan, and Saudi Arabia, there's a big shift towards solar. So we see it as being more competitive and the most prevailing source of renewable energy. Now, going back to Masdar, Masdar was established in 2006. And I believe in that short period of time, we have accomplished a lot. Today, we have an operating asset in Abu Dhabi, the Shams project. We do have the largest wind farm offshore in the UK, London Array. We have also on the ground delivered the Siemens building, which is Elite's Platinum when it comes to sustainability. We've also recently announced another investment in the UK, Dudgeon Offshore. But also on a more exciting note, we've also announced our partnership with the Solar Impulse project, which will be the first airplane to fly on a global scale without a drop of fuel oil. It will be completely powered by solar with batteries and flying 24 hours. So it will depart from Abu Dhabi and come back to Abu Dhabi. Now, to me, this project, I think, thank you. I think this project to me is very important. Why? Because when I talk about London Array, when I talk about Shams, people don't relate to it. But when I tell my son that, look, there's an airplane here that flies 24 hours without a drop of fuel, and it'll do it, you know, in March, it makes green clean technology a reality. People start associating with it.
And people get excited, yes.
Exactly, and I think we need more of those to create the link, as His Excellency mentioned. We can strive to create efficiencies in the system, but if you don't get people's awareness up, you can't achieve the full sustainability.
Mr. Salah, I know you're working closely with Masdar too. Looking at the rollout of solar, particularly in the Northern Emirates. Bring us up to date, too, with what you've been working on and what's going on there.
We are working very closely with Masdar to build a 50 megawatt power plant in Northern Emirates as a part of UAE strategic plan 2021. Nowadays, I think we are expecting solar to take a huge part of UAE market. As the new technologies coming through, there are general reduction in cost of unit price of the electricity produced. Implementation of PVs and CSPs projects set a target of 5 to 7% of power mix in the country actually, and with price escalation of natural gas, other renewable sources looks economic and more visible day by day, actually.
I'm sure many of you have had a look at the wonderful model that's out there of some of the work that's going on in Dubai, and it's very impressive. And a lot of that already put in place, but you're moving to a second phase on this. Tell us more about what's going on in the Dubai solar projects, because I know it's okay. You've got an exciting future on that one for us.
Actually, we started the first phase last year. It was inaugurated by His Highness Sheikh Mohammed. It's about 13 megawatt connected to the grid. And the second phase we started, of course, in the middle of the year. And we prepare the tender document and we float the tender. Now, we are waiting for the bidder to give us the result. This will be a different type of project. This will be IPP project. IPP, it means that independent power plant. And we'll create a vehicle, a company. DEWA will own 51% and the private sector will own 49%. I think this model is good, and it will be BOO, it means built and operate. There is no transfer because we study that it is very cost effective, and also it is good also for the developer and the operator to have it as BOO. And I think this is the start of the project. By 2030, maybe we'll have more than 1,000 megawatt. Definitely the prices, I agree that the prices presently is 70% less than 10 years ago. But still, the prices is higher than, the current price of normal the electricity. Maybe it's 5 times. But I think with the next 5 years, maybe in 2020, we'll see maybe the prices of solar unit cost will be equivalent to the natural gas.
And definitely that's what everybody will be expecting and looking for. Mr. Gradman, please come in here. When we look at Germany and particularly some areas in Europe, we often see them as, you know, the trailblazers in terms of sustainability and renewable energy and all of that. But, you know, for once, I think, here in the UAE, we're probably quite grateful that we're not maybe the leaders. Mm-hmm. It's not all wonderful in the solar scenario in Germany and places yet. They've had some obstacles that they're still working through. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that is exactly the right question. Yeah, because not everyone worldwide has to do the same and do the same traps and mistakes. We discussed retrofit. We discussed the clean coal technology, which is a so to say a must-have for a system. The next step is, how on earth do I integrate these huge amounts of gigawatts wind and solar into a system? And that is where we're experiencing right now the difficulties. And the key element is a distribution grid. We have bidirectional power flows. We need a completely different dynamic forecasting of supply and consumption. And it's completely disconnected from each other. So we have flattering peaks on a daily basis. So the whole management, the planning, planning, the management of grids changed tremendously. And we underestimated that completely. Yeah, we always talk in public about how nice it is to have so many wind and solar. But when it comes to these decentralized elements, it's a completely different system.
And Mr. Altair, so you've had the opportunity to really build this system new. When you look out at the sustainable energy future, where is that for Dubai right now? Where do you see the sustainable energy future for the city?
I think you have a supply side and you have a demand side. I think in the supply side, I already mentioned about Dewa, for example, the line loss, the customer minute loss. We have also the lowest worldwide. We have about 5 minutes against Europe, about 16 to 20 minutes per customer. Now, if you look about the demand side, there is a problem at the demand side because still, I think per capita, we are maybe the second or the third in the world as a wastage of energy. Now, how to rectify this is by having initiative such as the district cooling, especially for the high-rise building. As you know that we have our population presently is 4 million. We have many expatriates and they residing on high-rise building. I think the efficiency, we could raise it to 40% if we utilize district cooling. Second thing, I mentioned earlier about the green building. Green building also will improve about 30%. And of course, there are many initiatives like changing potable water to, especially for irrigation, utilizing the treated water instead of potable water. I mean, this is also will protect the environment and the planet. There are many initiatives, and I think we should work toward that. Especially, I think we are encouraging the ISCO company. Presently, we created a company, we call it Al-Tahad company, in order to do a huge work, actually. When I mentioned 30,000 building, it means that a lot of investment, a lot of work, and we actually established the infrastructure for that, and we have the regulator, and even the funding, we have the funding. It means that a building owner, he can change his building without spending. He will have two options, whether he should spend or he will actually allow to take his saving from the electricity. So there is two options, just to make it flexible to the investor. And I think if we concentrate on the demand side, we will be able to be in advanced position.
And also you're reflecting what I'm hearing. And Mr. Saleh, you even said to me earlier when I said I'll give you 2 minutes to talk about sustainability, you said you only need two words, consume less. So tell me, how are you going to get people to actually consume less? How do you go after changing the hearts and minds and saying to people, it is not okay to have the lights on all the time?
I think conservation comes as a national need to ensure security through maintaining natural resources. Everybody knows how much this sector is subsidized by the government. Recently, United Nations Development Program announced that Arab countries need to invest $200 billion only in the next 10 years for water sector only. So we in FIWA launched a consumption campaign as a long-term strategy plan, aiming to change the behavior of our consumers. We are targeting certain categories in the society. We are targeting school students. We are targeting housewives, mosques, and governmental building. As my colleague, His Excellency Saeed Tahir, announced earlier or stated earlier, that we need to enhance the knowledge. We need to look for partnerships. as I stated earlier, that sustainability means less consumption. We have also launched a UAE conservation prize, which we hope to change the behavior and the culture. And to my understanding, that the Ministry of Energy is working very closely now on a federal law on conservation, which will be a mandatory.
So if we can't just lure people, we're going to make it, it's something that they're just going to have to do. Yeah. Come in on this, Dr. Grellman. You talk a lot about demand-side management and when you're talking with your clients and putting projects in place too. How important is that? And Mr. Altair just mentioned it too, the demand-side management.
Yeah, I think we had already some of the ingredients which are necessary to form an overall holistic view on that, and that is probably for me the most important thing, that you can't say let's focus on, don't switch the light on. That is too short for me. I'm always looking for the kind of convenience, for example, in a house, and that would combine the solar PV on the roof with smart technology inside and smart appliances, the smart meter, the immobility part, so everything integrated, which leads to a kind of different life, a different kind of using energy, and therefore not only saying you must now reduce it, but also saying, look, we have a kind of convenience part into that, and that is only possible if we combine all the different measures.
If I may, Dr. Belhoul, we're all excited about your new flight, and we'll be all behind you on that one. But again, come back to the day-to-day use for the consumer, because ultimately they want their life to be, you know, more efficient, even as Dr. Grellman's there is saying. We don't, in a way, want to be told not to do things. So how do we get into maybe more smarter technology whereby, you know, there's sensors in place that the lights turn off? The burden doesn't become on it. I mean, what's Masdar doing in that level? Yes, building sustainability in, but really making it relevant, you know, to you and me and to everybody here, that it becomes a way of life.
Again, I go back to my previous point, and I think sustainability is basically a culture. Now, if you go back one generation or two generations back, our grandparents were one of the most sustainable people. They only drank and they only eat exactly what they needed.
And they were very organic and everything
exactly.
Was in place, yes.
So what happened is, with the introduction of wealth, we have a generation which is so used to wasting and consuming. Yeah. Today, the UAE and the GCC as a whole has the highest consumption per capita when it comes to water, to energy, and the highest waste disposal as well. But I think on the good news, we are now seeing a new generation of highly responsible young Emiratis. When I say responsible, I talk about all fronts. They are eager to do volunteer work. They're eager about their environment. We have interns that come to Masdar because they're excited about the project. And I think the future is bright. We may have, during our journey, have lost our way, but I think that culture is coming back and it's embedded in our DNA. We just have to re-emphasize it. So from Masdar's angle, I think one of the blessings of my job is it's a corporate and it's also a tourist attraction. I get a lot of school children visiting me. I get a lot of ministers visiting me. So what we do is we walk them through Masdar City. We show them the sustainability metrics that we have put in place. Today, we did actually a test. We measured a street in Abu Dhabi. On the same exact day, an hour later, we measured a street in Masdar City. The differential between the two was anywhere between 7 to 11 degrees Celsius. That's mostly because we tried to engineer the city, because we had the luxury of building it from scratch. So what did we do? We took into account the heritage of the UAE, because nobody knows how to live in the hot weather except our parents, right? So we incorporated the mishrabiya, which is like a natural cooling mechanism. We also had the buildings close to each other to provide shading. And I think we've also oriented the city for the shamal wind. So having the small little measures, I think, beyond getting into the technicality of it, provides a strong foundation to make a city which proves to be a green print for other communities to look into. So that's our part of creating a model that we can showcase to people and say, look, sustainability is coming, and here is a project in place in the UAE which delivers that.
And also, when you look at the institute, the Masdar Institute, so yes, we need to educate the consumers, we need to educate the population, but we also need to educate the engineers.
True.
and the people to build on the next level? And are you getting more interest from, particularly from Emiratis, to be joining the Institute, to be, you know, training as engineers as they are around the country in other areas, but looking particularly at the sustainability side?
I think initially when we first set up Masdar Institute, the challenge was, do you have sufficient scale? Because remember, this is not undergraduate, this is only postgraduate. So it's only master's and PhD, and it's purely focused on renewable energy. So our concern was, by establishing such an institution in collaboration with MIT, so top-notch academic research, our concern was there won't be enough scale. So we've also extended scholarship for international students. But to our pleasant surprise, there's a big uptaking. Today we have a big proportion of Emiratis, men and women, in Masdar. In fact, we have one person who went through Masdar Institute, joined Masdar City. He went to Spain in one of the projects to develop it, and he is now working in Shams. So he's been through the whole life cycle with us. And I think these are opportunities where we can develop the talent, because developing the city, developing the plant is one thing, but by developing people and instilling that behavior in them creates a ripple effect in the economy.
Now, Mr. Altair, one of your focuses too, of course, is on developing that talent, and you're going to need more of it as these projects get bigger. But tell me how DEWA specifically incorporates the sustainability into the implementation of the major energy projects. It's a project management conference here, okay, and people, I'm sure, are interested in how do you actually do that?
First of all, let me elaborate regarding the smart grid. Actually, this is a mega project. The cost of this project about 7 billion. Start from the from control center to the transmission, distribution, and to the customer. It means that the household or the DEWA household will be able to manage the demand from his house. And also for move in, move out customer, will of course save the time and the effort not to coming the electricity. Now, regarding actually most of our project, we require that environmental impact study to ensure that the commitment of the emission it's targeted at place. And also, I think efficiency is very important. Most of our project, especially in the generation side or transmission side, in generation side, most of our plant, nearly about 90% fuel utilization efficiency. So we actually concentrate on the efficiency in any project that we have.
And when you look at these projects and when you initiate these projects, also I believe now that DEWA is building in risk management and building in better and, you know, more rugged structures into what you're going to do when you take on a project, look at it and really see it through to the end. How important is it that, again, bringing it back to sort of the project management of it, that you have the right people in place, the key people there that will actually
go through? Definitely. I mean, always we recruit high caliber people, and this is very important. We have to ensure that the project delivered in time. We have to be very, very selective with respect to the contractor and consultant, and in order to ensure that, especially now the growth in Dubai is very high, we have to ensure that project deliver in time.
Indeed, yes, looking at Cityscape last week and seeing the momentum back and everybody who's got stuck in the traffic these days, we have that feeling that momentum's back. So it's DEWA definitely has to be ready when you look ahead for the future out there. Mr. Grellman, when you talk to clients in the region too, are you encouraged with their curiosity and also perhaps the knowledge they have and the commitment they actually have to sustainability here, because they're also at perhaps an advantage in a way of building new greenfield projects?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you have a little bit to distinguish again between the huge investments of new power stations. Yeah, that really is a thing which should last for 20, 30 years. But when it comes to the demand side, of course, that is still a kind of trial and error. Means tested on a small scale, like 100,000 households, like we did in one of the German cities, and then trying to establish and to test different technologies and how they work. And that is also what we discuss here in that region. Don't put all the cards in one basket here. Try out what works best and then go after that.
Well, when you look at the data coming from OPEC and coming from the International Energy Agency, you know, it is about that diversification of all fuel means, really, when you look at it. We're not going to be able to go renewable, you know, in the very near future. We can't totally depend on cleared coal. We can't totally depend on nuclear. We're waiting for that diversification.
Yeah.
And again, when you talk about the different diversification and what you're putting in place to really drive the city forward, is that really the focus for now? Because in the near future, we're still dependent on fossil fuel. We will have a mix, but it's about bringing, slowly bringing
definitely
cleaner on board.
As I mentioned, that presently we have about 99% gas, and still the gas will remain up to 2030. But I think it will phase out by time. Definitely depends also the renewable and the solar based on the prices. As I mentioned that, by 2020, I think the prices will be equivalent to the gas price. And at that time, definitely, we don't know what is the LNG price will be. But I think also we have to make some incentive in order to encourage the public and the society to install the solar panel. And actually, we are going in Dubai to have one initiative connecting solar energy direct to the houses, and also for the building they can connect it to the grid. It means that this will encourage customer and society to promote renewable.
And when you look at a time frame for that, I mean, are we looking more at big buildings, villas, the entire living population here that can begin to contribute?
I hope that with the first quarter next year.
Okay, this will be good. Mr. Salem, when we look wider in terms of you're looking at the Northern Emirates and the growth of development in that region and the growth of more industrialization too in that region, you know, it's all moving very fast. Are you doing enough in a way maybe to keep up with the sustainability? It's fine building all of this, but yeah, can you in parallel build the sustainability into the system?
Yeah, actually FIWA is responsible to provide power and water to all its consumer in Northern Emirates. Our plan based on 6% growth. We have approached all the local governments in the Northern Emirates to provide their master plan. It will enable FIWA to anticipate the required demand. As you know, there are international concern about the soaring price of the natural gas. Today, UAE is a net importer of natural gas. As per the national agenda for 2021, UAE government opted for a power mix, and I think by 2021 it will be 5 to 7% solar, 25% of nuclear power, and 68 to 70% will be on natural gas. So the dependency on natural gas will reduce from, as Mr. Said saying, 99% to around 70%. That will be a good achievement. And I think, you know, and again, I think more regulations to be set to encourage into implementation of best practices, like what's been implemented in Dubai, building codes and other things which will enables to have more sustainability, actually.
And also, I think it adds the clarity to people, because sometimes perhaps people are not sure. So sometimes by really putting those regulations in place and saying, this is how we're going to do it, because we're making a better choice for the benefit, really, you know, of citizens here and of the growth of the city. We heard Mr. Alabar talking earlier about the speed and the life that the cities are what people talk about.
In Abu Dhabi, what happens is if you get your electricity bill, you actually get the tariff and you get the actual true cost. So you as a consumer realize how much the government is spending. I think by addressing that, fundamentally can change sustainability. And I think the technology is just an add-on to that.
Mr. Sella?
For me, it's a change of behavior.
And that has to happen. I leave you the final word, Mr. Altair.
Yeah, I think the government and the customer is to change the mindset and the behavior. This requires a lot of program and a lot of support from both sides. But also, I think from the government, we are working with in the government of Dubai, is the smart government and smart grid. This will help the consumer to conserve and protect the environment.
Indeed, and that has already been put in place, so it's about everybody now moving in that one direction, and it's always great when you know where you're going, it's easier to get there. Yes. Gentlemen, thank you so much. I'd like to thank all of my guests, His Excellency Saeed Altair, thank you so much. His Excellency Mohammed Sala, thank you so much. His Excellency Dr. Ahmed Belloul, thank you, and to Dr. Klaus Gelman. Thank you so much, gentlemen, and I really appreciate your time. Thank you all, too, to our lovely audience.